And as we turn to Scripture, we learn what today's word of the day is.
And our word for today on this Wednesday in the octave of Easter, Wednesday, April the 12th, our word for today is astounded. Astounded, our word for today. Our reading from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3. Peter and John were going to the temple area for the 3 o'clock hour of prayer, and a man crippled from birth was carried and placed at the gate of the temple called the Beautiful Gate, every day to beg for alms from the people who entered the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked for alms. But Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." He paid attention to them, expecting to receive something from them. Peter said, "I have neither silver nor gold, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, rise and walk." Then Peter took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles grew strong. He leaped up, stood, and walked around, and went into the temple with them, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the one who used to sit begging at the beautiful gate of the temple, and they were filled with amazement and astonishment at what had happened to him. Our responsorial psalm, Psalm 105, "Rejoice, O hearts that seek the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, invoke his name, make known among the nations his deeds. Sing to him, sing his praise, proclaim all his wondrous deeds. Glory in his holy name, rejoice, O hearts that seek the Lord. Look to the Lord in his strength, seek to serve him constantly. You descendants of Abraham, his servants, sons of Jacob, his chosen ones, he the Lord is our God. Through the earth his judgments prevail. He remembers forever his covenant, which he made binding for 1,000 generations, which he entered into with Abraham and his oath to Isaac."
Our gospel acclamation from Psalm 118. Alleluia, alleluia. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. Alleluia, alleluia. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus. And they were conversing all about the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped, looked downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have taken place in these days?" And he replied to them, "What sort of things?" They said to him, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, how our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And because all this, it is now the third day since this took place. Some women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described. But him they did not see. And he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are! How slow of heart to believe all that the prophets spoke! Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that, while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us when he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?' So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, 'The Lord has truly risen. He has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon. Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread.
Astounded, our word for today, our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading. These he shared at his general audience on May the 24th, 2017. Jesus' encounter with those two disciples appears to be completely fortuitous. It seems to be one of those chance meetings that happen in life. The two disciples are walking deep in thought, and a stranger comes up alongside them. It's Jesus, but their eyes are not able to recognize him. And therefore, Jesus begins his therapy of hope. Therapy of hope. What takes place on this road is a therapy of hope. Who administers it? Jesus. First, he asks and listens. Our God is not an intrusive God, even though he knows the reason for the disappointment of those two men. He gives them time to be able to deeply fathom the bitterness which has overcome them. Out of this comes a confession that is a refrain in human existence. We had hoped, but. How much sadness, how many defeats, how many failures there are in the lives of every person. Deep down, we are all a little like those two disciples. How many times we have hoped in our lives, how many times we have felt like we were one step away from happiness, only to find ourselves knocked to the ground, disappointed. But Jesus walks with all people who are discouraged, walking with their heads hung low, and walks with them in a discreet manner. He is able to restore hope. He is able to restore hope. We had hope, but. Just one more thing, Lord. Just one more thing. If I could just have that one more thing. I'm almost there. You've almost made me content. You've almost got me to the point of satisfaction. I believe in you. And I really think if we could just do this one more thing, I'll be there. Isn't that all of us? You know what really strikes me about this reading today? As we're reading through it, this is what struck me. Again, our word for the day, astounded, going back to the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3. Peter and John were going to the temple area for the 3 o'clock hour of prayer, and a man crippled from birth was carried and placed at the gate of the temple called the Beautiful Gate every day. Every day he was there begging for alms from the people who entered the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked for alms, but Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." He paid attention to them, expecting something from them. Peter said, "I have neither silver nor gold, but what I have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, rise and walk." I have this question, brothers and sisters. He's at the temple gate every day, it says. He's begging there at the Beautiful Gate every single day at the temple. Did Jesus go there? What are the odds that Jesus was at that temple? What are the odds that Jesus was at that temple more than once? What are the odds that this man had heard every story about all the healings that Jesus had performed, and then Jesus had made himself present right where he was a few times, and nothing? What are the odds that he thought, "Well, what about me? I've heard about these stories here, there, and everywhere. Why aren't you doing anything for me?" Because the time had not yet come. And I'm sure that as he heard the rest of the story of Jesus, this Jesus that he had heard so many miracles about had now been crucified, he said, "Oh, well, that's the way that goes. There's no authenticity there." That, you know, turned out to be that way. And yet here we see Peter and John coming to that temple gate. They encounter him. And by Jesus, through Jesus' name, by the power of Jesus Christ, the man is healed. And then people see him, they recognize him, they know this man who begs at that gate every day, and the testimony that goes out about this healing then converts, draws interest, creates a curiosity for so many others around this man and around this area. Now was the time for this miraculous healing to take place, not only for the benefit of the beggar, who was blind, but also for the and crippled, but also for the benefit of those who would encounter him, those who would see him. And I said blind, not blind, crippled. And they heal him of this of him being crippled, and he's walking about, and people are encouraged and inspired, and now they see that the power not only existed just in the person of Jesus, but now his followers are moving in the same power as they speak forth his name. And this healing, this transformation of life continues forward. And people are astounded when they see him. Just as the two on the road to Emmaus are astounded when Jesus breaks the bread. But first they went through that time of disappointment. Can you believe it? The women had come to them and said, Jesus is risen. And their idea was, oh, we're leaving. Mm-hmm. For them, it wasn't about that. For them, it was about God, about Jesus redeeming Israel, about setting them free from the Romans. That was their priority. And when that didn't occur, they were done. And it's this, the beginning of that gospel reading is interesting too. That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus, and they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And then Jesus comes up and asks them what they're talking about. They talk to him about it, and they say that the women had encountered Jesus risen from the dead, and some of their number had gone to check it out. Some of their number had gone to check it out. Not them. They didn't go. And they said, some of our number went and checked it out. And yeah, the tomb was empty, but they didn't see Jesus. That was enough for us. We were out of there. And then Jesus encounters them on the road and brings the whole reason, the purpose for his life, the purpose for which he had come. He gives them an understanding of that, that it supersedes everything that they thought or hoped that he might accomplish. And then they believe. And believe me, then they lay down their lives. Then they do all they can to spread this gospel, even to the shedding of their own blood. Because now, as Jesus opens their eyes, that astonishment finds a home in them, that it might find a home in us as well, as the Lord works in our lives, and we remove that hope. I have hope, but. I have hope, but. Now, remove that. Not one more thing needed. The only thing needed is Jesus. Astounded, our word for today.